Well, hi, guys. Hey. Hello to all of our campuses, those of you who are healthy and who are here, trying to ward off the evil spirits that are out there somewhere in our fair land, right? And I hope you are staying healthy. We have been in a healthy discussion for the past few months of the life of Jesus through the Gospel of Mark. And as Vertical sings, we're not done yet. We are in Mark chapter 6. And if you want to turn your Bible to Mark chapter 6, verse 30, feel free to hold on to that. And we'll get to that in just a minute. But we want to continue to be reminded that Jesus has all authority. And that is the starting point for all of this. Our title today is Reaching the Masses. And at first blush, that might sound like we're kind of shallow and that we're only concerned with numbers. And so it begs the question, is reaching the masses a worthy or a righteous goal for us to have? And I put some verses in your note page, and you can even look at them a little bit more fully later, but you're probably acquainted with some of these verses. And this is what Jesus has to say on that subject of are we to reach the masses? In Matthew 28, 18 through 20, that's a passage that Harvest has loved, the Great Commission. It's been a key verse in the life of this church where Jesus is talking and he says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Over in Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, we have Jesus talking as he is about to ascend into heaven. And he says to his disciples and his followers, he says, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. So it's a ripple effect, and it keeps getting bigger and wider. So Jesus wants us to reach the masses. He says it quite clearly in Mark chapter 16, verse 15. It says, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the entire creation. So Jesus makes it crystal clear that we are to try to reach the masses and preach to them the gospel. Now, there's one passage that I wrote down that you might not be as familiar with, and it's Matthew chapter 24, verse 14. And here Jesus says, and this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So trying to reach the masses was Christ's commission, and doing so is a prelude to the end of time. And since this is Jesus' goal, it has to be a worthy goal. It has to be a righteous goal. And the more that we, as the body of Christ, mature as a church, the more potential we have in actually reaching the masses. Think of it like this. Church health creates church growth. When something is healthy, the natural response is growth. When an 8-year-old child stops growing and they don't grow and they turn 9 and they grow 10 and they grow 11, the parents don't just say, oh, well, it's no biggie. There's no need for concern. That would be insane. It would stand out. Health results in growth. And within the church, when the body of Christ is actively sharing their faith with others and strengthening those who are already believers, the result becomes growth, spiritual growth, numerical growth, healthy growth. The church that is both evangelizing and discipling has no choice but to grow deeper and to grow larger. And it's exciting to see that happening right here at Harvest. Now, this week in Mark, we come to a story that you might be kind of familiar with. Other than the resurrection of Jesus Christ, this is the only miracle of Jesus that is recorded for us in each of the four Gospels. And what makes this unique is that it is one of the few miracles where an entire multitude benefits from it. We call it the feeding of the 5,000. Now, that's important because in a few weeks, I'm going to be in the Gospel of Mark, and I'm going to be teaching on the feeding of the 4,000. And these are two different events. And so this week, when we say the feeding of the 5,000, that is a reference to the number of men who were present that day. You see, back in that culture, sad to say, but when they would count, they just counted the men. And so they didn't count the women, they didn't count the children in this count. So we understand that this crowd is much larger than the way society saw it. When they say it was 5,000 men, we deduce from that that it was probably 10 to 12,000 if you throw in the women and if you count the number of children who are there. But remember the setting of where we are in Mark chapter 6. Last week, Pastor Ed preached for us. He did an awesome job. And he talked passionately about the suffering and what the disciples were going through due to the death of John the Baptist. And this was a brutal death. It was the beheading of John the Baptist. And here was one of Jesus' closest friends and his cousin, John the Baptist. And Jesus, now knowing all that the disciples have gone through, grieving this loss and just finding out about it, in the midst of their busy travel schedule that they've had ministering, Jesus decides to pull them away so that he can have some alone time with his disciples and they can process what's going on. Now, in order to reach the masses, Jesus knew that there were three needs that had to be met. So I want you to look in your Bible at Mark chapter 6, and we're going to begin with verse 30. It says, "The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, 'Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while.' For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a desolate place by themselves." The first need that had to be met was the disciples need rest. We were not made to work nonstop. We learned a few months ago, back in Mark chapter 2, it says that the Sabbath is for man. So rest is for you. I love that Indian proverb that says, you will break the bow if you keep it bent all the time. If it's always bent, it's going to break. You see, rest helps you become more productive. Farmers realize this in their farming. It's very normal to leave a portion of their acreage unplanted. Why is that? Well, farmers rotate where that unplanted area is from year to year, and the dormancy and the rest for that piece of ground and soil actually causes it to give an even greater yield the next time that they plant a crop there. Jesus always saw the value of rest. And on numerous occasions, we find him pulling away from the masses. Why? So that he could just be with his heavenly Father. He could just be alone with his disciples. He could just have an extended time of prayer. And the disciples especially need some time and rest because they've had a full schedule of traveling and ministering in recent days. And now they've just received this sad news about their friend and co-laborer, John the Baptist. And maybe they're wondering, I wonder if I'll be next. And so Jesus gets them all to hop into a boat, and they're heading for an uninhabited, quiet place to be by themselves. Now, I know we're all wired differently. We're all made differently. We all have different personalities and temperaments. But there are some of us that have a harder time resting than others. Put your hand up at our campuses if you are a type A driven person. Put your hand up. I see some spouses reaching over and putting their spouse's hand up. They didn't, right? So if you have a hard time pulling away, if you have a hard time getting some rest, understand that if patience is a fruit of the Spirit, then hurry is not. It can't be. And the Lord himself tells us to be still. But oh my, we have a hard time being still. I have a terribly hard time standing still and being still. I just rode from Elgin to here, and my wife, who has heard this sermon now twice, is saying, well, I really like that part about slowing down and rest. And I hope that you heard what the preacher was saying, you know? I'm like, okay, all right, check, gotcha, right? I'd much rather stay on the move, even if I'm not sure what direction I'm going. I like the activity, right? Because in our culture in America, we believe that busyness equates with success. And so the danger in our Christian life is that we will become so distracted and so rushed and so preoccupied that we will eventually settle for a mediocre version of the Christian life. But God knows that we need rest. And that's why he established boundaries. That's why he established the rhythm of having a Sabbath. And Jesus has all wisdom, and in his humanity, he knows that the disciples need a break. He knows that he needs a break. Look at verse 33 in Mark chapter 6. Now many saw them going, in other words, getting in the boat and leaving, and recognized them, and they ran there on foot from all of the towns and got there ahead of them. So this is our first hint that this break, this time of rest, is going to be short-lived. And when Jesus and the 12 get in the boat, these people see them get in the boat, and they start scanning from the horizon and watching them and following them, and they're trying to guess where it is by the direction that they take off, where it is that they're going to go to. And so they all just start spreading the word, and people start following on foot. The crowds were craving his teaching. Well, why? Well, earlier in this series, back in Mark 1, we learned that Jesus was different than all the other rabbis because when Jesus taught, he taught with authority. The word was shmiha. And when he opened his mouth and taught, everybody listened. And anyone would follow a new rabbi with a new teaching who had authority. They would follow him so far that they would even break through a roof in order to lower their paralyzed friend down just so that that person could have an audience with Jesus Christ. Well, we're going to discover a second need that must be met on this particular day, and that is that the crowd needs nourishment. The crowd needs nourishment. Mark chapter 6, look at verse 34. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. So Jesus loves people. Have you got this picture here? They make it to the other side. Great, we're going to be alone. We're going to have some time to ourselves. Gets out of the boat, starts walking up the hill. From the other side of the hill, there comes this multitude. And they have tracked him down, and they can't believe that they have found Jesus, and now they're going to get to be with him. But Jesus loves people, and even when he's exhausted, even when he's grieving the death of John the Baptist, Mark inserts this simple phrase, and Jesus had compassion on them. Can you think of a time when someone has shown you kindness? Think of a time when someone has shown you compassion. Maybe it was something that was totally undeserved. Maybe it was from an unlikely source, and yet somehow they expressed to you compassion or grace when you desperately needed it. As I was working on this message, my mind drifted back to an experience when I was 15 years old. A long time ago, my parents were in ministry, and they were about to get some rest by taking a 2.5-day trip with another couple who also desperately needed a break. Now, my dad is a pastor, but he, at that time, was the dean of a graduate seminary. And so all I could think of was, this is going to be awesome. Mom and dad are going to be gone for 2 days with no parental involvement in my life, right? But he sat me down, he called my brother in. My brother was 18 at the time. Said, hey, we're going on a trip. We're going to be gone for 2.5 days, and we're licking our chops. And he says this. He says, I'm going to have you all stay down at the dorm. And said, well, why would we stay down at the college? He said, well, that way I can have the resident assistants and the resident directors just kind of keep an eye on you all. I said, well, don't you trust us? And he said, no. So they left for 2.5 days, but when they left, they made one tactical error. They met up with this other couple on the college campus. Mom had driven there, dad had driven there, and so I'm thinking, this is awesome. No sooner had they left, my brother brought me the car keys to the Blue Beauty, a Dodge Dart, a chick magnet, all right? and said, hey, he said, Dave, you've been a relatively decent brother. He said, here's what I want you to do. Sometime in the next couple days, just take it out for a spin, make certain it's running properly while I'm away at work. I said, I'm not worthy. But I was an obedient brother, and so I did. Now, I was 15 years old. In Cincinnati at that time, you couldn't get your permit. You couldn't get anything until you were 16. So I had no business driving. I was unlicensed, and I didn't even have a permit. But I hung out, and I waited for secretaries to come out of buildings, and I'd say, hey, Angie, where are you going? I'm going to the other side of campus. You need a ride? Hop in. I'll give you a ride. I'd ride her over there and drive her there. I'd say, when are you coming back? About 10 minutes. I'll give you a ride back. So I ran a shuttle service for lonely secretaries for two solid days. Every single person that got in the car with me, I said the exact same thing. I said, hey, whatever you do, don't tell anybody, all right? This is our secret. Oh, Dave, don't worry. Nobody's going to tell on you. Nobody's going to tell. Well, everything went great. My parents came back in town. The first day, everything was fine. The second day, everything was great. The third day, my dad came home from work. He slammed the door. My dad's not a slammer. He said, boys, I want to see you in my study. We went into a study and sat down. He slammed that door. My dad started pacing. It wasn't even a big room. He just started pacing back and forth. You ever seen your dad pace? Finally, he stops. He looks at me. He says, is there anything that you boys want to tell me? Well, they had been gone for 2.5 days. We had done a lot of different things, all right? And we didn't know exactly what they had on us. And I've always lived by a very simple principle. Never confess to a felony if he only has you for a misdemeanor. Yeah? So he says, is there anything that you boys want to tell me? I said, we have nothing to declare. And my dad, being a pastor, immediately begins to spout off an impromptu parable. No lie. First line of what he says. A certain man went on a journey out of town with his wife. Oh, no. I know where this is going. Certain man went on a journey out of town with his wife. Before leaving, the man entrusted two sets of car keys to his older son, who in turn entrusted one set of car keys to his younger brother, who proceeded to drive around the campus of Cincinnati Christian University, even though he did not have a driver's license. What should happen to these two boys? Dead silence. He said it again. What should happen to these two boys? Finally, my Sunday school training kicked in, and I said, as surely as the Lord lives, the elder brother must die. As I recall, my dad did not think it was that funny. And later that year, when I turned 16, my dad said these words to me, happy birthday, but you're going to have to wait a while to get your driver's license. Oh, wow, you mean, you talk about a way to hurt a 16-year-old boy. And I'm like, oh, no. But 2 days later, he walked into my bedroom and he said, let's go. And I'm like, let's go. Let's go where? Prison? You know, I didn't know. He said, let's go get your license. I said, oh, man, are you serious? He said, yeah. He said, I think you've learned your lesson. I said, I've learned my lesson. Thank you so much. And he took me to get my driver's license. And that was a time when someone showed me compassion and kindness that I really didn't deserve. Back in Mark chapter 6, what Jesus did was beyond the call of duty. Mark writes, he had compassion on them. And the word that he chooses to describe this compassion is deep of a term. In other words, it comes from the very recesses of within a person. That's where his compassion comes from, rooted within him, in his heart. He saw them as sheep without a shepherd. This is a figure of speech that denotes a lack of guidance. But that wouldn't last long, since the good shepherd was there now. And his kindness and compassion was greater than his grief and fatigue. And that's important for us to see. You see, Jesus realized they needed nourishment through, first of all, spiritual food. Jesus felt compelled to teach them. Luke's gospel tells us that he taught about the kingdom of God and even healed their sick that day. His concern was so great that he taught and he taught and he taught. Verse 35 and 36 of our text. And when it grew late, the disciples came to Jesus and said, this is a desolate place and the hour is now late. Send them away to go into the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat. This teacher had captured their attention. No one wanted to leave Jesus. Their empty stomachs took a back seat to the way their hearts felt as he spoke. And so most theologians think that they skipped two meals that day because of their long journey that they made of covering a lot of miles. They skipped lunch and they skipped dinner now. They'd hiked all around the Sea of Galilee. They came in droves by the thousands, a group without a leader, a multitude of misery and sickness, bringing nothing but requests. Lord, would you do this for me? Lord, would you do that for me? Nothing but requests. They came with open ears and an open spirit to hear what Jesus would say to them. And yet, this tired, grieving master gives them kindness and compassion. But notice this, the disciples don't share Jesus' compassion. I mean, it's been a long day. They've missed lunch. They've missed dinner. Nobody's leaving. Jesus is healing. Jesus is teaching. We're going to be here for a while. Now, the disciples, typically when they address Jesus, they talk very respectfully and they will say to him, Lord, Lord. And then they'll go into what their request is. But not this time. They skip the Lord, Lord part. And what they virtually do is they give a command to Jesus. I want to make certain you get this. They command Jesus. Frail and perfect man commands the perfect Son of God and what it is that they want him to do. And they say, Jesus, send them away. Send these people away. Let them go get some food on their own. Translation, we're not responsible. They chose to travel here. The tickets didn't say that a meal was included. And so they're just trying to get rid of them. But Jesus is not perturbed by their disrespect or their lack of compassion. He simply issues them a challenge and looks back at the disciples and says, you give them something to eat. And leaves it at that. See, here's the second nourishment that Jesus knew they needed. They needed physical food. They needed physical food. In other words, the disciples are saying, hey, we're out here in no man's land. There is no Portillo's close by. There's no Chick-fil-A around the corner. They walked miles to get here, so now they're going to have to walk miles back home. There's no nearby billboard advertising out in the boonies catering, specializing in large groups on short notice. And so the disciples say, send them away. Get rid of this crowd. It doesn't sound real loving, but the truth is sometimes ministry can become tiresome and frustrating if you don't get the rest that you need at times. Here's the third lesson that we need to see. The disciples need training. The disciples need training. Jesus is going to have to do some training and some teaching for his disciples. And who better to use in this setting for training on servanthood than Jesus, the ultimate servant. So there are three components to this. Serving, first of all, means recognizing the need. I mean, you've got to be perceptive. You've got to say, oh, well, there's a need here. Look in your Bible at verse 37. Verse 37 says, but he answered them, you give them something to eat. And they said to him, shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat? John's gospel gives us a little bit more insight into this and says that Jesus says this because he's testing his disciples and that he already has in mind what it is that he's going to do. Here's the second lesson in this. Serving requires evaluating the resources. In other words, do an inventory and find out what it is that we have available. Let's make use of everything that's at our disposal. But look at verse 38, Matthew 6. And Jesus said to them, hey, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. And when they had found out, they said, five and two fish. So John's gospel tells us from where this food comes from. This food comes from a little boy. So out of thousands and thousands of people, No one ever dreamed that when they left that morning and started following after Jesus, that they would still be there as the sun's about to go down. And so it just hasn't registered with them because they are in the company of Jesus Christ. And time just flies, and it's like, I can't believe this. The sun's starting to go down. Look around. Is there any food around? Well, yeah. Andrew finds a guy, a boy, who has five loaves and two fish. That's pretty small. I mean, that would be hors d'oeuvres for the 12 disciples. But there's not 12 people there. There's over 5,000 men, not to mention the women and children. I went to a wedding and a reception last month, and I didn't know how long all the festivities were going to go. So you know what I did? I stuffed in both of my suit pockets protein bars and granola bars, right? And I just didn't know how long things were going to go. Every time somebody would give me a hug, it would make this crinkly noise, right? And but you never know. So I came prepared. I was like a little squirrel, and I stored up some snacks for when I got hungry. Later, my wife said, "Hey, your eating was a little loud during the wedding vows." So I'm sorry about that. But maybe you do the same thing when you come to church and you see I'm preaching. It's like I better bring some snacks with me, right, in case he goes too long. By the Sea of Galilee, with this massive crowd who had missed two meals, all they could muster from the group was five small loaves and two sardines, and that's it. So the master is going to teach his disciples in the crowd the most important lesson, and here it is. Serving takes relying on Jesus. Serving takes relying on Jesus. Perhaps this boy was embarrassed by how meager this would be among the masses. But I want you to notice something. The boy doesn't give his lunchbox to the crowds. He gives it to the Christ. He didn't give his food to the masses. He gave it to the master. Verse 39 says, "Then he commanded them all to sit down in groups on the green grass." I don't know about you, but that sounds kind of strange to me. Okay, why the detail of the appearance of the grass? Why would Mark even include that the grass is green? Well, it further drives home the truth that one of the other accounts says that it was around the Passover, which would mean that it's around the spring. And at that time is when the soil is the most moist, and so the growth is the greenest at that time. And so maybe that's why, is just to confirm the timing fact. But most people think that Mark shares it for another reason. It is a conceptual parallel. He is directly alluding to the 23rd Psalm. In the 23rd Psalm, what is it that the Lord who represents the shepherd, what is it that he does? He makes me lie down in green pastures. And so Mark brings that out because after all, he's already said that these people were like sheep without a shepherd. And Mark is driving home the truth that the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. Jesus is my shepherd. Look at verse 40. So they sat down in groups by hundreds and fifties. This is another peek back into the Old Testament, back when the Israelites were wandering in the wilderness and God fed them with manna, and they would sit down in groups of 50s and 100s. And so it's a callback, a bookend to what God, how he provided back then in the Old Testament, and here in the New Testament, we're seeing how God still provides. Verse 41 begins this way. And taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing. So what he's doing is he's praying. He's communicating that we want God's intervention. And when you pray, you know what you're communicating? You are saying we want to live by the Spirit rather than walking in the flesh. That's what you're saying when you choose to pray. You're saying, you have a better way, God, than my way. And so I trust you on this. Look at 41 and 42, those verses together. And taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. And he divided the two fish among them all. And get this, they all ate and were satisfied. You're thinking, wait a second. I think you must have skipped a couple of verses, or maybe there's some verses that are omitted because you just lost me. What just happened? I mean, he prayed, he broke the loaves, he divided the two fish, and they gave them all out, and everyone ate to the point where they didn't want any more. They were totally satisfied. They were totally full. How does this happen? Well, they had five loaves of bread and they had two fish. And the disciples are thinking, game over. He's looking at this measly meal and Jesus is about to say, okay, yeah, you guys are right. Yeah, you guys are going to have to go on home. It's about dark. You're going to have to go find some meal closer to the village where you live. Thanks so much for coming, all right? But Jesus doesn't do that. And the disciples give us an honest picture of who we tend to be. We tend to work in the flesh rather than live by the Spirit. We think that we've got it all figured out based purely on the numbers. Oh, this will never work. But I want you to rewind the story. Let's go back. Rewind back a little bit. Lord, we've got one boy. He's got some food. What's he got? He's got one loaf, two loaf, three, four, five loaves, and we got two fish. So we got five loaves and two fish. Okay? So we got one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. That's all we got, Jesus. The odds of that measly meal meeting the needs of this multitude are minuscule. I don't know how we could even set odds for a meal that paltry feeding 12,000 people. The odds are greater, the likelihood is greater of Donald Trump and Nancy Pelosi having a delightful picnic tomorrow, all right? That's about what it would have been like. And the disciples look at Jesus and they've done their inventory, they've counted up to seven, they've got it all figured out, and they did what we do. We look from an earthly perspective of what we can do rather than what God can do. And my question for you today is, I wonder if Jesus was frustrated that they stopped counting when they got to seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And I wonder if Jesus was just begging them, saying, you know what, you have some more things at your disposal. Well, no, that's all we've got. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And I wonder if Jesus in his heart is begging for them to count to eight. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Oh. And Jesus makes eight. We got Jesus. Forgot about Jesus. We got Jesus. If you got Jesus, it doesn't matter what you have over here. Jesus makes all the difference. Jesus is the one that makes up the difference. And when you count on Jesus, you will learn to count to Jesus. And you'll realize that he's worth counting to. Jesus is saying, you can count on me. You can rely on me. I wonder how many times we've stopped counting a little bit too early. In your marriage, when you say, well, you know what, God, it takes two people to save a marriage. And Jesus is up there saying, hey, include me in on the count. Or in your workplace where you feel like you're all alone. And Jesus says, no, you're not all alone. I'm here with you. Count me in. In your pain, when you feel down, when you feel depressed due to a circumstance or the loss of a loved one or something that you're going on, you count on Jesus. You count to Jesus. The disciples stopped at seven, and so do we at times. What if we were to count to eight? When life is tough and the odds are against us, Jesus has all authority. Include him in your count. The passage concludes in verses 43 and 44. This is what it says. It says, they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and of the fish, and those who ate the loaves were 5,000 men. Now, that's pretty impressive on a lot of fronts. It's impressive that he did the miracle. It's impressive that he calculated it out so that everyone was satisfied. And then on top of that, that with thousands of people, there were only 12 baskets of leftovers. Some people say that the 12 baskets of leftovers are a veiled reference to the 12 tribes of Israel. Maybe that's why there were 12. You know what I think? There were 12 disciples too. And I wonder if each one of them got a leftover basket to serve as an eternal reminder to them to not count to seven, but to count to eight. A physical reminder of a day that they would never forget when they learned to count on Jesus and count to Jesus. You see, our job is to meditate less on the math and more on the master, the Lord of creation, the powerful provider, for only he can satisfy our deepest needs. Paul Tillich, the German theologian, says that there are three needs within each and every one of us that nothing in the world can satisfy. You know what those three needs are? Number one, the need for cleansing from guilt. The world can't take away your guilt. Jesus willingly went to the cross. He became a perfect sacrifice to pay for our sins. And for those who put their trust in him, their sins will be forgiven. But God always does immeasurably more than what we ask or imagine. So what does he do? He makes it better. He doesn't just forgive our sins. He takes away the guilt of our sin. Psalm chapter 32, verse 5, written by King David in the New International Version, a guy who knew something about sin, knew something about forgiveness, and also knew something about guilt. And he says this, "I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." He'll take away your guilt. The next need that the world can't fulfill is the desire to have meaning in life. You have purpose in life. We exist to glorify God. We have been made in his image. And our life becomes the response to what he has given to us. And the final need that the world can never satisfy is the ability to live after you die. How do you beat that one? There's only one way. Put your trust in Jesus Christ, because he walked in the grave and he walked out of the grave, and because he conquered death. If you swallow your pride and you put your trust in Jesus Christ, you can walk out of your own grave too. Jesus fulfills our every need. My chains are gone. I've been set free. When we think about reaching the masses, we drift our minds back to Billy Graham crusades or Kanye West popping up in different cities and holding large impromptu worship services and people making decisions for Christ. And we're quick to express, well, the reaching of crowds, I mean, that's for somebody else. That's not for me. But we all have a role to play in reaching the masses. A preacher can preach to thousands of people at one time. Why? Because of a lot of other people. Because of an awesome tech team at every single campus, staff and volunteers that use their gifts just to make it possible to reach the masses. A CEO can impact the employees of a massive company through their faith in Christ, through their moral integrity. But we may be unaware of the godly grandmother who took that CEO to church as a child when his or her parents were uninvolved in their life. And they weren't shaping them the way they should and pointing them toward Christ. Look at this situation here in Mark 4 or Mark 6. Jesus takes a child's meal and both divides it and multiplies it at the same time and feeds thousands. But don't forget and don't miss out that Jesus did the miracle, but he didn't do the miracle until after other people had played a role in the process. There was an introverted disciple named Andrew who lived in his brother's shadow, Simon Peter. And Andrew was the one who was out with the people. And he's the one who stumbled onto the boy. He stumbled onto that one boy, and that one boy had a meal. It wasn't much, but it was something. Why did he have a meal? Probably because he had a faithful mom who that morning didn't know what her son would get into and where he would end up. And so she packed a lunch for him. Do you see the ripple effect that happens when we try to do something one at a time? You see, the best way to reach the masses for Christ is one at a time. That's how it happens. We pour into one person at a time. We meet one need at a time. We share our faith with one neighbor, with one coworker. And in our world, we're so drawn to numbers and size, and we think that represents strength and power. But the reality is that there is a power in one. especially when one is followed by another one, and another one, and another one. I just left the Elgin campus after the service was over. I was talking with a family. Ended up 10 or 11 folks came down there. And as they got ready to leave from talking with me, one of them said, "Hey, you talked about the power of one. That's how we all got here, was one person in the circle that was impacted by Christ, and it had a ripple effect. And now they're all on fire for the Lord." The Gospels are filled with numerous everyday encounters that Jesus had with one person at a time. And while the world chases the crowds, Jesus loved the one right in front of him. Will you do that this week? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we openly confess to you that when it comes to counting, we usually stop one short. And Lord, we covenant with you today that we will try to do better in that area, and we will count to 8 instead of 7, that we will have faith in your extraordinary power and we will rely on you. We thank you for supplying all of our needs, and may our lives reflect our gratitude and love for all you've done. And may we reach the masses as we share our hope in Jesus, one at a time. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.